folks, Dr. Rossendale here. We are marching closer to the Civil War. We have a little something called war drums. What I'm doing here is I'm snapping those mystic cords that Lincoln called the things that connect the North and the South. Once upon a time, Americans belonged to national organizations. In roughly 1845 or so, those national organizations start snapping over the question of slavery. And certainly by the time that we get to the election of 1860, people tend to look upon themselves regionally. You're a Southerner, or you're a Northerner, more so than through nationalistic eyes. It's political, judicial, religious, economic, oh, and social. Those are the cores that we're going to snap in the next, 15, 20 minutes. Not everything, not everyone was focused on slavery. Way up in the Pacific Northwest, there was this little tiny place called Seattle. It was a fishing village. It was a bunch of places where lumberjacks hung out. And then there's competing Genesis myths over how Seattle came to be. There's a guy named Brewster Denny that created the Territorial University of Washington. Wanted to bring more highbrow folks to the region, I guess, as opposed to those other people, those fishermen, those lumberjacks. I don't know. The Territorial University of Washington opened up its doors in 1861. So we have the first students in 1861. So when the Civil War begins, the University of Washington opens its doors to its first students. This was it in 1861. That was it. That building is still on campus today. The original bell, of course, is not there. That's where I took that building, I should say, is where I took my first year of Arabic one summer. Texas. Texas abolished slavery, but there was still some concern in Texas, in Mexico, about some Americans' ideas on Texas. In part, Mexico is looking to create this another buffer zone. Secondly, there needed to be a more influx of money and of, what's the word I'm looking for? Development. Mexico government, the Mexican government is going to allow Americans to move there, provided they do a couple things, become Catholic, give up slavery, and everything else. For the most part, they're not going to do. You guy named Austin Moses. Wasn't it Moses Austin? Sorry about that. Different Americans will show up either individually or as a group. Moses Austin led a group. He's going to establish a little outpost. That outpost is going to grow. We eventually have a movement towards independence, which the government of Mexico will not be all that excited about. We have Santa Anna and his army. They march through Texas. They take the Alamo in San Antonio. Very disappointed the first time I visited San Antonio because the Alamo was right there, right next to the Riverwalk, right? You know, San Antonio, I expected it, like the movies, to be way over there somewhere in some sort of field. Not the case today. Anyhow, what we have after that is we have a guy by the name of Houston ends Santa Ana's running around through Texas. Texas. But here's the important part. There's this area that neither Texas nor Mexico can really figure out who belongs to what. Texas claims that their southern border is the Rio Grande. Mexico claims that Texas' southern border is the Nueces, closer to San Antonio. So in order to keep things nice and clean while they're negotiating, U.S. troops are pulled north from Nueces and Mexican troops are pulled south of the Rio Grande for the most part. And then we had a U.S. president named Polk who kind of had some U.S. troops go south, like real south, near Corpus Christi, and there was some unpleasantness resulting in the deaths of some American soldiers. And so Pope goes to Congress and asks for a declaration of war. And bingo, bango, bongo, the United States is involved in its first foreign war, the Mexican-American War, 1848. It's a very, very popular war. It's a very short war. There are a few people who stand up against it. One is Abraham Lincoln, which is why Abraham Lincoln will not get reelected to Congress. Like I said, it's popular. But here's what we got. Here's what we're getting to, folks. The Treaty of Guadalupe. The Treaty of Guadalupe is significant because it suggests a continuity in U.S. foreign policy, namely that unlike European nations, the United States will write big fat checks to foreign governments for land as opposed to just seizing it, which is what Europeans did, like the French and like the English. So the United States will write a check to Mexico for a couple of reasons. One, the United States invaded almost all the way down to Mexico City, and there's going to be a tremendous amount of damage to civilian population. And so part of the check is to compensate the civilians of Mexico who were killed or the property damaged. Second is going to be, for the territory, for what became the American Southwest, California, New Mexico, Arizona. And then the last part is this, and this is the genius of it all, at least where I'm sitting. Mexico and the United States came to this agreement, and what about all the Mexicans living there? And you had a choice. You either go back to Mexico, or you stayed here and become American citizens. If you're going back to Mexico, you obviously can't take the land with you. So the third part of the big fat check that the U.S. government will write to Mexican government is, to compensate the Mexicans who went back to Mexico after the war. But I think it's interesting that at a time of racial animosity, that the United States will look upon people who clearly are not as white as Western Europeans, who are coming here from over there, they're going to look upon them as citizens and as equals, because it's not going to be that much longer after this that the Supreme Court is going to decide that a large group of people living in this country are not citizens. And so we have the Treaty of Guadalupe that's going to bring in a large amount of Roman Catholic, Spanish speaking, for the most part, people as American citizens. So we're talking Texas, what became New Mexico, Arizona, and California. California becomes really, really, really important because shortly after the agreement between Mexico and the United States is completed, we got a lot of gold being pulled out of California, which is going to make a lot of Protestant Americans believe that God is on their side. A lot of gold, a lot of people, okay, flying to California looking for that gold. The result is going to be this. Within 2 years, California is going to be admitted or wanting to be admitted in the United States as a state. It wants to be a free state. Northerners say, of course. Southerners will say, no, California is too long. Maybe cut it in half. I don't know. There's actually another group in California that doesn't want to become part of the United States. They want their independence. Anyhow, so a guy named Henry Clay will take a whole bunch of ideas and slap them together as what's known as the Compromise of 1850, or as I prefer, the Armistice. The Armistice is a ceasefire, and that's really all these political agreements in 1850 mean. Congress is just kicking the can down the road. They're not settling, really, the big question. Although Abraham Lincoln will think so. This is what he says. All the big questions of the day have been answered. So here's what we got. California is admitted as a free state. Texas loses part of its land to New Mexico. Federal government pays off the debt that Texas incurred when it was an independent country. The slave trade in Washington, D.C. comes to an end. Not slavery, the slave trade. Popular sovereignty will be the thing that the slave question will be decided in the rest of the territory, popular sovereignty. And so that's why folks like Lincoln, a lot of other Northerners are going to think, hooray, that's it. In large measure because there is a larger population up north. So they'll move in greater numbers than Southerners, and so all that new territory will become free states. We have a new fugitive slave law, however, which is what a lot of Southerners are saying, yippee. The fugitive slave law now states, or the Constitution said that if you're a runaway slave, you're not free. I mean, if you move, if you flee to a free state or area, you're not free. And then you have the right as a slave owner to get your slaves back. But of course, the Constitution didn't say how that was going to happen. The Fugitive Slave Law of 1850 says how it's going to happen. There's going to be a new court set up. There's going to be judges who only hear that cases about these suspected, alleged runaway slaves. And so what's going to happen is that slave owners are going to send slave catchers up north. Sometimes they'll grab runaway slaves, but they'll also be grabbing a lot of free Africans. And there's going to be these trials. And over again, the judges are going to find that these black people to be indeed runaway slaves. The problem is that the judges get paid $10 when the judges find them to be runaway slaves, and only $5 when the judges free them. So there's an economic impetus to find these black people slaves, and that's what's going to happen. Anyhow, just 2 years earlier, 1848, was a presidential election, and three of the four people had a statement on slavery. Lewis Cass, the Democratic candidate from New York, stated that slavery is a big deal and it needs to be answered, and the answer is popular sovereignty. Well, let the people vote. A Democrat believing in government is best at the local level, very Jeffersonian. So instead of the federal government having this national policy, we'll let each state come up with their own. Two, Martin Van Buren, ex-president and a free soil candidate, he is going to be against the expansion of slavery. Allow slavery to exist where it exists, but don't allow its expansion out west. That's not because the free soil movement was against slavery. They were pretty much just against black people. They didn't want black people moving out west. You have the outgoing president Polk, a Whig, who says yes, slavery is important. And it was up to me. Here's how we answered it. We would take that old Missouri Compromise line, the 36th, 30th parallel, and just move it all the way to the Pacific Ocean. Everything north of that will be free. Everything south of that will be slave. Then you got Zachary Taylor, the Whig candidate, made very famous during the Mexican-American War. And so he is asked, what about slavery? And he says, it's not that important. Now, he used to have slaves, but he set them free. What does he not feel about slavery? He said there's other things to talk about. Well, he's the guy that wins the election. So in 1848, can we then conclude that Americans didn't think answering the slave question is that big of a deal? Because they vote for a guy who says, answering the slave question is not that big of a deal. But it becomes a big deal with the discovery of gold and the really, really quick request of California to enter the United States. So there are all sorts of examples in the Christian literature about the acceptance of slavery. Here's just a couple of examples. And Christians use the Bible to justify slavery. God supports slavery because here's all these citations. These people, you know, these biblical personalities had slaves, so clearly slavery is okay with God. Well, Americans became Protestant for a whole bunch of reasons. One, I'm sorry, Americans supported Protestantism for a whole bunch of reasons, including this one. Protestantism is democratic. Catholicism is not. If you're a Catholic, you don't have any say. You don't get a vote on who your parish priest is, what the Pope decrees. If you're a Protestant, however, you do get the vote. You elect your minister. You debate, you discuss, and you vote on policies. And so, by the middle of the 19th century, more and more Protestant groups are raising that question, should we have a position on slavery? And if so, what is it? Well, they debate and they vote and they vote, and they cannot agree on should they be in favor of slavery, like their Bible suggests, or should they be against slavery, which is a new which is what which is coming out of the abolitionist wing. And so here's what we got. By 1850, the Presbyterians, the Baptists, and the Methodists all split over the issue of slavery. So the Presbyterians, the Methodists, the Baptists were a national organization. So prior to 1850, you belonged to the Baptists. The Baptists are going to split, creating the Northern Baptists and the Southern Baptists, the Northern Presbyterians and the Southern Presbyterians, and the Northern Methodists and the Southern Methodists. So over the issue of slavery, the religious cord has snapped. And now more and more Americans, by 1850, do not belong to a national religious institution. They belong to a regional religious institution. You got the unrestricted expansion, the Fifth Amendment, right? The one that says Congress can't take away your property without due process. You got the popular sovereignty argument, the idea that people should be allowed to vote on what they believe, that government is best at the local level. So this would be the Jeffersonian approach. You have the restriction, the people who support a federal government, the people who support the first part of the Constitution, the original part of the Constitution, the originalists. And so Congress makes the rules for the territories. And so Congress can say no slaves in these territories. And that actually had been going on, starting with the Northwest Ordinance in 1787. And then you had compromise. And that actually was what had been going on. Compromise. But compromise means kicking the can down the road. Compromise is not answering the question. Compromise is saying we'll deal with it later on. We will simply allow it to exist as it exists, the status quo ante. Well, Stephen Douglas was a supporter of popular sovereignty, a Democrat, a senator from Illinois. But then he takes what's left of the old Louisiana Purchase Territory, and his committee, the Committee on the Territories, creates two new territories, the Kansas, which is south of the two, and Nebraska, which is the more north of the two in 1854. And popular sovereignty will be the mechanism for how the people in those two territories will answer the slave question. And the reason he does this, one, he supports popular sovereignty, and two, he wants a federal railroad to be built with a hub through Chicago and over territory that he owns. Then he could sell that land to the federal government or to the railroad. But he needs a Southern votes in his committee for this to happen. So he officially supports popular sovereignty. This is going to result in a bunch of guys losing their heads over this whole thing and saying, yep, yeah, we're done. And so they're primarily a lot of old Whigs. And so they go to Wisconsin. Ripon, Wisconsin, R-I-P-O-N, and they create the Republican Party. But in 1854, the Republican Party had one idea. That was it. The idea was this: allow slavery to exist where it exists, but they will not allow the extension of slavery outside of that area. So, I mean, this is the Wilmot Proviso, folks, the thing that David Wilmot attached to the appropriations request to settle the Mexican-American War. And so we even have Northern Democrats who are calling to secede from the Union. Things are getting really ugly really fast. You have pro-slavery forces rushing to Kansas. You have anti-slavery forces rushing to Kansas, and they start killing each other almost immediately, if not sooner. You have Lyman Beecher, well-known, maybe one of the two most well-known ministers at that time. I think a guy named Hale was the other. Edward Everett Hale? Anyhow, so Lyman Beecher will tell his flock, you know, go out there. And he'll send these folks presents. People out in Kansas refer to them euphemistically as Beecher's Bibles. What they are is they're brand new weapons, rifles, long guns. Yeah. Lyman Beecher's daughter is probably more well familiar to you. Harriet Beecher Stowe, who wrote Uncle Tom's Cabin. She writes, I think Uncle Tom's Cabin came out in 54. Was it 56? Is it 52? Anyhow, Uncle Tom's Cabin, or Life Among the Lowly, is out there, also causing quite the stir. Queen Elizabeth will say, when she read it, she wept. Very, very, very popular. I think something like 10% of the American population read the book by the time we get to the Civil War. And so the Republicans, 1854 was a non-presidential election year, and the Republicans actually gained control of the House of Representatives. So there cannot be any more compromise, folks. Can't be. 1856 is the presidential election, the first presidential election since the establishment of the Republican Party, and they float this guy, John C. Fremont, who's a well-known Western explorer and Indian fighter on his own. And he doesn't win the election. Abraham Lincoln is the first Republican to win as a Republican, but Fremont gets something like 33% of the vote, which is incredible for a party that only existed for, 2 years. So there are developments here, folks. Dred Scott was a slave, although he spent the majority of his life in Wisconsin. Scott's master dies. Scott sues for his independence, for his freedom, and he gets it. And then they go back and forth until we get to the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court will decide a couple things. One, Dred Scott is a slave, because the Constitution clearly states that if slaves are in free states or territories, they're not free. But and here's where things get really interesting. The Supreme Court will say that Scott is not a citizen, that only citizens can use the court system, meaning that Africans, free or slave, cannot be citizens. He states that slaves are indeed property, so he will uphold the Fifth Amendment over the rest of the Constitution, the first part of the Constitution that gave the power of Congress to make the rules for the territories. Also declares the Compromise of 1850 and the Missouri Compromise may be unconstitutional. So there are a tremendous anxiety up north, which is going to make them dig in their heels. And there's tremendous celebration down south saying, I told you so. This is all because of judicial review. Remember when the Supreme Court gets the thing, they get to look back at everything else. And if necessary, rule on it. So it's quite possible that the Supreme Court is going to nullify every single agreement, every single compromise, because they said you can't compromise. Fifth Amendment, your property, take them wherever you want. We went to bed one night, old-fashioned conservative compromise, and waked up stark mad abolitionists. That is from Amos Lawrence of Boston. A relatively wealthy family. But then we had Anthony Burns. Anthony Burns is one of these folks who was picked up by slave catchers, and there's going to be a trial, and he's going to be, found to be a slave and sent into slavery. But there's massive riots over this. The federal government has to send in troops, to escort Burns to the ship that's going to carry him into slavery. And so, as a result of what happened to Burns, we have Lawrence saying, "Well, here's a bunch of money. Why don't you guys go to Kansas, establish a city? Let's call it Lawrence, Kansas, and that's going to be the hub, the center of the anti-slave movement." Meanwhile, you got this guy, John Brown. John Brown, anti-slave, believes that God wants him to be his Saint Michael. And Brown goes to Kansas with a number of his supporters, and they seek out and they kill people with pro-slave sentiments, which happens along the Pottawatomie Creek. They just go after him with their broadswords. The extent is that John Brown becomes well known up north. Charles Sumner, a Republican from Massachusetts, is giving a speech in the Senate on the evils of slavery, and he talks about slave owners, you know, raping their female slaves, and he names names. Senator Ben Butler, Democrat from South Carolina. Well, shortly thereafter, Ben Butler's nephew, Preston Brooks, a congressman, goes to the Senate, knocks Sumner to the ground, and beats Sumner until Brooks's cane snaps in two. So Preston Brooks becomes a hero in the eyes of Southerners, and the violence inherent to slavery is introduced into the hallowed halls of the U.S. Senate. George Templeton Strong was a Northerner who held ideas that were relatively common at that time, namely that slaves probably had it better off than Northern factory workers, because slaves got things like food and shelter. So he was opposed to slavery until the caning of Sumner, and then he came out with this: slavery is the greatest crime on the largest scale ever known to history. Damn. He joins the Republican Party, and he helps lead the U.S. Sanitary Commission during the Civil War. We'll talk more about the significance of the Sanitary Commission later on. If you have any questions, folks, you know how to get a hold of me. Oh, what do we got here? Is this about A New Hope? Let's see. Yes, A New Hope. Our Republican Party and all these other events that are happening in the 1850s certainly will bring a new hope that slavery will be coming to an end. It is going to get really ugly, though, folks, really quick. And let's see what happens when we look at the election of 1860. So I think that's next. And so I think this is it. And so I'll go like this. Bye.